Today we're going to be talking about schizophrenia spectrum and other psychotic disorders, which corresponds to chapter 8 from your text. So first we'll talk about the symptoms, diagnosis, and course of the disorders. Then we'll talk about biological theories, psychosocial perspectives, and then finally we'll finish on treatment. So what is psychosis? Psychosis is the inability to differentiate between what is real and what is unreal. So it's kind of like there can be delusions, hallucinations, but people who have psychosis believe that these perceptions that they experience are real. So, many times that we hear noises at night, people who have psychotic disorders will very strongly believe that this is, you know, for example, a ghost or something else like that. And even though we may have those thoughts, we know in our heads that that's not true. Somebody with psychotic disorder wouldn't be able to differentiate what's real and what's not real. And there may not even be any precipitating thing like a noise that started that. So schizophrenia is a severe form of psychosis where individuals alternate between the following phases: clear thinking and communication with accurate view of reality and proper functioning of daily life, and an active phase of illness where their thinking and speech are disorganized, where they lose touch with reality and have difficulty caring for themselves. So we associate schizophrenia very strongly with the second area here, with people who are active phase of the illness. So schizophrenia spectrum, these refer to the five domains of symptoms that define psychotic disorders. They include four kinds of positive symptoms and negative symptoms. And then the number, severity, and duration of these symptoms distinguish one psychotic disorder from another. And we'll talk about each of these. All or just some psychotic symptoms manifest in individuals suffering from schizophrenia, and the disorder differs across individuals. So positive symptoms. These are overt expressions of unusual perceptions, thoughts, and behaviors. These include delusions, so ideas that an individual believes to be true but are highly unlikely or impossible, kind of like the CIA implanted an electrode in their penis to monitor them. You might think that's funny, but I've had people who've told me that. A lot of people do have delusions where they believe that they are famous when they're not famous, that they believe that a famous person is in love with them. Often when you hear about Hollywood, people that have stalkers or people that are found in their houses, these are people with delusions who are experiencing that these people are their boyfriends, etc. Hallucinations are unreal perceptual experiences where you see things, hear things, smell things, or feel things on your body that aren't actually there. These can be auditory, where you hear voices, or they can be tactile, where you can feel them. So in terms of positive symptoms, there's formal thought disorder, where there's a tendency to slip from one topic to an unrelated topic with little coherent transition. So this would be, and I'll try to give you an example here, I'm not going to do it so well. So I'm watching the baseball game, and then my mother baked some bread, and then after that we went to the store, and then I saw the fly ball come into the home base, and then it hit me in the head, and I ate the bread, and then it made me very hungry, and I wanted to sit on the couch and fall asleep, and then I ran into home base. So, I mean, while there was some connection there, because I'm not so good at doing this, you can see that that while I was speaking, there was really kind of little coherence to what I was saying. So it refers to loose associations or derailment. It can also be that you're having a conversation with somebody and you ask them a question like, what's the weather like? And you can say, well, I hate tornadoes because tornadoes, they can really devastate the world. And then, you know, I heard on the road the other day the politicians talked about global warming, and then from global warming I really feel like the politicians are out to get me. And so they're kind of just going on, you know, in streams of consciousness. There's also disorganized or catatonic behavior, where people display unpredictable and apparently untriggered agitation. So they can get agitated very quickly by a simple question, by touching them. Their behavior doesn't necessarily make sense. They look a little bit weird, for lack of a better word. Some people experience catatonia, so this is disorganized behavior that reflects unresponsiveness to the environment. So they'll actually be, you know, potentially like holding their arm in these strange positions and not moving, or just, you know, not being responsive to the environment, kind of just sitting there with a dazed look on their face. So these are different types of delusions. There are persecutory delusions. Those are ones where people are out to get them. Delusions of reference, that, you know, when they see something on TV, they think it's a very special message directly, specifically to them. There are delusions of grandiosity, that they have great powers, knowledge, or talent, that they're famous musicians or famous actors or famous politicians when they're actually not. their delusions of being controlled. So they feel like there's something or somebody outside of them that are controlling their thoughts or feelings. There's thought broadcasting, where they believe that people, that whatever's being thought inside their head, everybody else can hear. There's thought insertion, where they believe that somebody's inserting thoughts into their mind. Or thought withdrawal, where they think that their thoughts are being removed by somebody else. Their delusions of guilt or sin, that they believe falsely that they've committed some sort of horrible crime for which they should be punished. There's also somatic delusions. The false belief that their body is diseased or altered, so that their head is much larger than it should be, or their body might be changing in shape or size. That doesn't necessarily make sense. The negative symptoms of schizophrenia involve the loss of certain qualities of the person. And so these often appear as if they're similar to depressive symptoms. So you see restricted affect. So there's a severe reduction or absence of emotional expression. So there's, you can tell jokes, you can have them watch TV, and there's very little reaction on their face. There's avolition, the inability to initiate or persist at common goal-directed activities. So they really just don't want to do anything. They kind of just sit there. There are also cognitive deficits in terms of attention, memory, and processing speed, which they've noted on kind of different types of tests. So you can see how this resembles very much depression. So cognitive deficits are observed in people with psychotic disorders, and these are deficits in basic cognitive processes, including attention, memory, and processing speed. So, in terms of diagnosis, according to the DSM-5, individuals must show two or more of the following symptoms of psychosis. In the acute phase, the presence of symptoms consistently and acutely for at least 1 month. There's the prodromal symptoms that occur before the acute phase. So this is kind of like, you'll see some weirdness, but it doesn't quite meet the criteria. There are residual symptoms that are left over after the acute phase, so there's still kind of a little bit of remnants, like they still have some belief in these ideas, but they're not necessarily accurate. So, two or more symptoms like delusions, hallucinations, disorganized speech, grossly disorganized or catatonic behavior are negative symptoms. For a specific portion of the time since the onset of the disturbance, the level of functioning in one or more areas is markedly below level achieved prior to the onset. So, this is a functioning criteria. They have to have signs of the disturbance persistently for 6 months. They have to rule out schizoaffective disorder, depression, or bipolar disorder with psychotic features. You can't attribute it to any other physiological or medical cause or the effects of a substance. So it can't be due to an illness, due to drugs, or due to medication. And if there's a history of autism spectrum disorder or communication disorder with childhood onset, the addition of diagnosis of schizophrenia is made only if there are hallucinations and delusions, because kids, people with autism or communication disorders might experience some of these types of behaviors just generally, so it's kind of different. So, prognosis, if somebody's been diagnosed with a schizophrenia spectrum disorder, what is their prognosis? Generally, people will be rehospitalized. That's probably likely at some point in their lives. The rehospitalization rate is somewhere between 50 and 80%. Usually people stabilize after the first episode within 5 to 10 years, but this is impacted by gender and age. So women tend to develop the disorder later and have milder symptoms and have a more favorable course than men. Functioning tends to improve with age, as with many disorders. There are also sociocultural factors and that affect kind of how families and people around them deal with these disorders. So in different developing countries, for example, they kind of say that people don't even have these disorders because they're cared for in the home. And sometimes people with schizophrenia are said to have special gifts, that their hallucinations are actually visions, and so they're treated very differently than they are in North American culture. It also is based on the social response and treatment available. So other types of psychotic disorders include schizoaffective disorder, which is a mix of schizophrenia and a mood disorder like depression. Schizophreniform disorder, which meets criteria A, D, and E of schizophrenia, but with symptoms that only last 1 to 6 months. So you're seeing much shorter duration of the symptoms, but they have hallucinations and delusions, for example. You have brief psychotic disorder, where you have a sudden onset of delusions, hallucinations, or disorganized speech or behavior that can last between 1 day and 1 month, but no longer than that. You also have delusional disorder, where you only have the presence of delusions which last for 1 month. And it's usually regarding a situation that's occurring in real life, but you're thinking about that situation somehow becomes delusional. There's schizotypal personality disorder, which is a lifelong pattern of significant oddities to self-concept, ways of relating to others and thinking and behavior. And these are kind of just those weird kind of recluse kind of people that they don't meet criteria for schizophrenia, but there's a lot of oddities to their behavior. So here are the diagnostic criteria for schizoaffective disorder. You have to have an uninterrupted period of illness during which there is a major mood episode. Delusions or hallucinations for 2 weeks or more in the absence of a major mood episode. So you can't have both depression and schizophrenia at the same time. You have to have hallucinations or delusions for a period of time for at least 2 weeks while you do not have mood disorder. The symptoms meet criteria for a major mood episode are present for the majority of the duration of the active and residual portion of the illness, and you can't attribute it to substance abuse or other medical condition. For schizophreniform disorders, we mentioned criteria A, D, and E of schizophrenia are met, but it lasts between 1 and 6 months. For brief psychotic disorder, they have delusions, hallucinations, disorganized speech, or a disorganized behavior, but it lasts between one day and 1 month. And then delusional disorder, it's a delusion that's present for 1 month or longer. They've never met criteria for schizophrenia. Their functioning is not markedly impaired, and their behavior is not obviously bizarre or odd. So many times, unless you're asking specifically about this delusion, you wouldn't know that somebody has a delusional disorder. And schizotypal, or some people call it schizotypal, personality disorder, it's a pervasive pattern of social and interpersonal deficits marked by acute discomfort with and reduced capacity for close relationships, as well as by cognitive perceptual distortions and eccentricities of behavior beginning by early adulthood and present to a variety of contexts like ideas of reference, odd or magical thinking, unusual perceptual experiences, odd thinking and speech, behavior and appearance that is odd, eccentric, or peculiar, lack of close friends or confidence, and it's not happening during schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, or depressive disorder. So in terms of biological theories, some people think that there's a genetic transmission, and there's evidence to suggest that schizophrenia runs in families. A biological relative with schizophrenia increases somebody's risk. They've done this through adoption studies in scope, and they found that, while they're definitely kids who were adopted and raised by parents without schizophrenia still develop the disorder, but at lower rates. So parents who have schizophrenia may create a more stressful environment for the child, and therefore, if they have a vulnerability, based on our stress vulnerability model, they may express the disorder. They also did twin studies where they looked at twins reared together and apart, and they found that there's a significant likelihood of twins having the disorder. And they're also finding structural and functional abnormalities in specific areas of the brain. So you can see here that there are enlarged ventricles on the right for people with individuals with schizophrenia. So there are some biological theories that birth complications or prenatal exposure to viruses affect brain development. They found that people who had viruses during the first trimester, if the mother had the flu or some other kind of disorder, were more likely to get schizophrenia. There are neurotransmitter theories, but there are excessive levels of dopamine, just like when we talked about substance abuse. People who have too much start hallucinating, and they're finding the same thing in people with schizophrenia. If we give them neuroleptics, which block the reuptake of dopamine, their symptoms decrease, and so and we know that drugs that increase the level of dopamine also give positive symptoms. So using neuroimaging studies, there's a presence of more receptors for dopamine and higher levels of dopamine in individuals with schizophrenia. There's also some evidence of the mesolimbic pathway, where their subcortical part of the brain is involved in the processing of salience and reward. And antipsychotics work by binding to specific types of dopamine receptors in the mesolimbic system, and they block the action of dopamine. So we also find unusually low dopamine activity in the prefrontal area of the brain in individuals with schizophrenia. And serotonin neurons regulate dopamine neurons in the mesolimbic system. And so these interactions with the serotonin and dopamine are critical for proper functioning. And they think that these are not functioning properly in those with schizophrenia. So you can see from this diagram here the prefrontal cortex, the mesolimbic pathways, and these are all areas of the brain where they're seeing differences in individuals with schizophrenia compared to normal controls. There's also psychosocial perspectives with social drift, with a tendency to drift downward in social class for individuals with schizophrenia, which therefore increases stress. That's why we see a lot of individuals with schizophrenia who are homeless and on the street. Because schizophrenia interferes with symptoms of schizophrenia interfere with people's ability to maintain job or education, they sometimes kind of fall through the cracks and end up in, you know, and many times families can't deal with them any longer. There's evidence that if you're born in a large city, that can be related to increased stress and also related to relapse. And there's some theories that families can stump the growth of autonomous sense of self, although there's very little evidence to support these theories. There is one theory of expressed emotion. They talked about the schizophrenic genetic mother, the overbearing mother that caused schizophrenia, and this was actually very harmful. But we do know that in families who have a lot of expressed emotion, which means that they argue a lot, this increases the stress to the individual with schizophrenia and can cause relapse. So a lot of the therapies involve working with the families to decrease stress from the individual. According to the cognitive perspective, there are difficulties in attention, inhibition of, and adherence to rules of communication. And so they learn to conserve minimum cognitive resources. And in using delusions, people try to explain strange perceptual experiences, and hallucinations or hypersensitivity to perceptual input, with a tendency to attribute experiences to external resources. And the negative symptoms are explained by they expect their social interactions to be aversive, and so they really just kind of come into themselves. They don't have to experience them anymore. From a cultural perspective, it's intermingled with biological theories, like stress, there's lack of spiritual piety, family dynamics, and so we're seeing that across culturally, schizophrenia is expressed somewhat differently, and people, you know, view the symptoms of schizophrenia differently. And so people who have more family support and more understanding from their communities tend to have better outcomes. In terms of treatment, we have antipsychotic medications which impact positive symptoms. Chlorpromazine belongs to a class of drugs called the phenothiazines, and they calm agitation and reduce hallucinations and delusions. They block dopamine receptors and therefore reduce its action on the brain. However, we see the side effects, which are akathisis, which kind of, you'll see people that start to stick out their tongue, they have, they kind of walk with a shuffle, and that's why you see, they're kind of symptoms similar to Parkinson's disease, which is caused by a lack of dopamine in the brain. And tardive dyskinesia, which is what the symptoms that I just discussed, can be caused by these antipsychotic medications, and so you see kind of involuntary movements of the tongue, face, mouth, or jaw. Atypical antipsychotics bind to the D4 dopamine receptor and influence several other neurotransmitters like serotonin. These are the newer ones that are being used. They have fewer side effects compared to the other one, but can cause agranulocytosis, and so they have to be monitored more carefully. There are also psychological and social treatments that can be used in conjunction with medication. These are not used instead of medication, because we kind of know that schizophrenia is a biologically based disorder, but we can use behavioral techniques based on social learning and operant conditioning. We can use cognitive restructuring. We can work on problem solving skills, and where we can work with families to kind of educate them about the illness, the prognosis, the course, and how to decrease stress for the individual. And you can also provide support for the family, because living with somebody who has schizophrenia can be very stressful. One of the newer interventions that's kind of taken off in the last decade or two is assertive community treatment programs. And these are treatment programs that, you know, while traditional treatment, you have the patient going to the therapist, in this case, the therapist goes to the patient. And it's a team of individuals that work together and are available to the individual 24 hours a day, such as medical professionals, social workers, psychologists. And they integrate various models to kind of work with the individual and provide them with housing and other social supports that they need. And they find that by doing this and going and helping the individual this way, they're providing a lot more stability, and people are having much better outcome. So you can see that here, there are much better outcomes. It's the purple group. And there's less need for people to be reinstitutionalized if they're participating in the intervention group and they're receiving, you know, these treatments. So there are positive effects of treatments for both the individual and the family.